old, persistent, international, highly coordinated and planned to bash Islam in a new crusade. But I conclude with the note of hope from the Quran. وَقُلْ جَاءَ الْحَقُّ وَزَهَقَ الْبَاطِلُ إِنَّ الْبَاطِلَ كَانَ زَهُوقًا. And say truth has prevailed and falsehood has vanished. Indeed, falsehood is bound to vanish sooner or later, inshallah. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على خاتم الأنبياء وسيد المرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. And I wish in the very beginning to thank you all for your coming this evening and to thank Brother Shabir, my dear brother, and all the tireless workers working for him or supporting him. This kind of seminars should not be simply in reaction to certain events such as the Nigerian case, which became an international cause in the media and resulted in a flood of letters to the editors, editorials, TV and radio appearances and all kind of arguments. And as you know, even right here in Canada, even our own government has sent an official protest to the Nigerian government. It appears that at the core of all of this confusion has been an Islam-bashing kind of attitude. But in any case, as the Quran says, وَعَسَىٰ أَن تَكْرَهُ شَيْئًا وَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ. You may hate something in which there may be some good, even though we should not just react. The recent attacks on Islam and Sharia and Muslims in general perhaps might provide for us a motivation to learn more about our deen. The way, inshallah, the topic is presented is divided into 8 areas, all organized along misunderstandings and misconceptions about Islamic Sharia, with the emphasis on criminal law and in particularly the issue of fornication and adultery. I list them first for your information to get a bird's eye view of the topic. First, Sharia means criminal code. I'm talking about misunderstanding, not truth. Sharia means criminal code. 2, Islamic Sharia is old, obsolete, should be either cancelled, modified, or at least modernized to fit recent times. 3, Islamic Sharia is incompatible with modern concepts of human dignity and human rights, international conventions on human rights. 4, if there is any conflict between those universal concepts and declarations and Islamic Sharia, it is Islamic Sharia that should be changed to conform to those standards. 5, Islamic criminal law does not leave any room for forgiveness or rehabilitation. It is simply laws for vengeance. 6, and you must have heard that a lot, Islamic Sharia punishments are barbaric, severe, brutal, whatever other terms that fall in the same line. And I'll end with 2 observations, brief ones, that's 7 and 8. One is application of the rules, inshallah, we hope to get familiar with, on the Nigerian case. Secondly, or the very end, the attitude of the media and politicians in the West. Let me take the first question. First, misconception. A lot of people, you must have heard, Sharia, it means criminal punishments. Even some Muslims themselves say, this country is going to apply Sharia. Oh, yeah, the cutting of hands and chopping of necks and all of that. So it has to be one and the same. I'd like to say in that respect two basic points. First of all, the term Sharia, if you take it from the purely linguistic point of view, it actually means a way. As an Islamic term, a specific technical Islamic term, it means what Allah has established as a way of life. So it is the way of life that Allah has chosen and prescribed for His servants, those who believe in Him and accept His guidance. Secondly, with this kind of definition, it becomes quite obvious that by definition, Sharia reflects the nature of Islam, not only as mere religion in the narrow sense, but as a complete way of living that includes all aspects. So there is Sharia in how to pray, there is Sharia in how to pay your zakah, there is Sharia in how do you make your fasting, as much as there is Sharia in organizing social, economic, or political activities and behave in the battlefield. And part of that as well, of course, is the criminal code. The bottom line then, in the first point, to conclude, that Sharia is not the criminal code, but criminal code is one aspect of the broad Islamic Sharia. Second misconception. Islamic Sharia is obsolete, old. You have to cancel, modify, or modernize to suit the times. This kind of statement should raise a couple of questions. First, is it by definition that anything that is old must be bad and obsolete? For example, this might be true when you talk about an old, worn-out garment versus a new one. But is everything old necessarily bad and obsolete? How about water? Water is very old. Adam used to drink it. Is it obsolete? Should we stop drinking water because it is old? Secondly, is it by definition that anything new is of necessity better, superior, more modern? Look at what's happening in our modern society. Air pollution, water pollution with toxic chemicals, pollution of the earth itself, the soil, depletion of the ozone layer, crimes in the street, brutality, wars. These are all modern things, aren't they? Are they to be superior by definition because they are modern or new? So the basic point basically is that when we evaluate something, we don't evaluate necessarily by time dimension, or by place. Things has to be evaluated on their own merits as to their validity or lack of it. Another question. The claim that things that are permanent in Sharia, and I'm not talking about ijtihads and details, the basics, need modernization to conform to the so-called modern world, in fact reflects a very grave misunderstanding of even the definition of Sharia, its source and its nature. Just to clarify, as we indicated earlier, Sharia means what Allah has made for the benefit of mankind. And you compare that with the laws made by human beings. Human beings, when they make laws, regardless of their knowledge, intelligence, education, experience, you name it, cannot help but admit that their knowledge is limited, so is their wisdom. Not only this, I don't think any sane person could deny that when human beings sit down to make laws, they could be influenced by some factors that make them biased, whether it's towards gender, or towards one group or the other. For example, overemphasis on the right of the criminal for due process, which is should be there, but overemphasis to the point of forgetting about the rights of the victims. So there's lack of balance, there is bias, there is lack of wisdom, and that's why laws keep changing. And as we have defined that from a Muslim point of view, Sharia originates from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All of those weaknesses and shortcomings and lack of knowledge and wisdom definitely has no application to him. The other aspect that is little known also, especially in the West, about the nature of Sharia is that it does not accept external imposition for change, but it does possess within itself a built-in mechanism to deal with the changing circumstances whenever there is need for that. This would enter into the category of fiqh. Fiqh means literally understanding, which means how a particular Sharia law can be implemented in a given situation, given the overall spirit of Sharia, its interconnectedness and interrelationship and cohesiveness. So that's there already, but not by external pressure or imposition. It is within Sharia and within its own rules of interpretation. The third misconception: Sharia is incompatible with modern concept of human dignity, human rights, which are universally accepted today. I'd like to raise at least three basic points here. First of all, is it true that Sharia is incompatible with human dignity and human rights? In fact, the opposite exactly is true. It was the Quran, long time before all of these laws and fashions and fads, that established the rule, as we see in Surah Al-Isra, Surah 17. وَلَقَدْ كَرَّمْنَا بَنِي آدَمَ. Indeed, we honored the human race. It doesn't say Muslims alone. Human race, just by being a human, qualifies the person for a basic human dignity. It was the Islamic Sharia that regulated the rights, the human, call it today human rights, I prefer to call it Sharia, right? The rights of people and their entitlement, as well as their responsibility in all spheres of life. And that's the comprehensive nature of Islam. Family life, social life, international life, all of that has been regulated. Secondly, I'd like to clarify again, when people speak about incompatibility and human rights, I just raise one simple issue. That is a subject of consensus among scholars. And the reason why it has that wide acceptability and consensus is that it is based on the primary sources of Islam, the Quran and Sunnah. They concluded, the scholars, that there are five primary objectives of Islamic Sharia: to safeguard faith, life, mind, honor — some take it in a wider definition, some take it at the minimum, the honor pertaining to protection of the family, protection of progeny, and wealth. And my question to the human rights so-called advocates: can you tell us which of the list, big list of rights that you talk about, cannot be included under one or more of those five categories? I'm not familiar with any. Everything that you can think of under the sun pertaining to human rights, so-called, would fall under one of those five categories. In that sense, Islamic Sharia, by definition, and its objectives and aims are not to encroach on the rights of people, actually to affirm and safeguard those rights. Secondly, let's ask the question also from another perspective. For those who keep talking about rights, 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 is there any other side of the coin to those rights? How about duties and responsibilities? Or are we just talking about rights? Here again we find the depth of the nature of Islamic Sharia. The duties as well as rights are just like the two sides of the same coin. And you know why? If I am fulfilling my duty and responsibility, then I am fulfilling somebody else's right. If I am doing my right as a husband, I am fulfilling my rights, wife, my children's right. If my son and daughter are fulfilling their duty and responsibility towards me, they're respecting my rights. So there is this reciprocity in rights and responsibilities. But then we should ask here, what value is there of such rights or duties or responsibilities if they lack enforcement, if there is no protective mechanism to make sure that these rights shall be respected? That's where we have a unique distinction of Islamic Sharia. That it does not just give you a listing like a motherhood statement. Oh yeah, yeah, preserving life, faith, and this is fine, fine. No. With each of these five broad objectives, there are also specific mechanisms to make sure that they will be implemented. And this could be both on the positive and negative, things that should be done and things that should not be done. Let's take example of these five. First, safeguarding or protection of faith. In the positive sense, it means freedom of belief, which is clearly stated in the Quran. لا إكراه في الدين, no compulsion in religion. It includes, by necessity, the right to practice one faith, to worship according to the kind of belief that he or she accepts. But it includes also defense of faith, especially in the Muslim community, against those who try to destroy it. It means also standing against blasphemy that belittles the social values based on deep religious values and disturbs and threatens the social peace. That's part of it as well. Safeguarding of life is not a slogan. On the positive side, we find the Quran emphasized that anyone who saves one life is like one who saved the whole humanity. That's fine. Muslim jurists extended that to say that it's not only saving life, but also the right to be saved if you're in danger, the right to be treated if you're sick, the right to be fed and sheltered if you're unable to do that for yourself. That's part of safeguarding life, not just a slogan, specific mechanism to get it enforced. But of necessity also, to protect that life or right to life, there have to be punishment for someone who disregards the right of another person to life, even if he has to pay with his own life as a result of that crime. Thirdly, safeguarding the mind remains an empty slogan until we find in the Quran and Sunnah the encouragement to nourish that mind, to encourage thinking, reflection, contemplation about the creation of Allah, freedom of expression, debate and discussion in matters that are of benefit to society and in a constructive manner. But then again, it remains theoretical until and unless we have legislation, as we do have in Sharia, against all kind of intoxication that beclouds that mind and prevent it, number one, from performing its function properly, and beclouding it in a way that could result in crimes and immorality in society. Otherwise, we're talking slogans. Safeguarding ard, as they call it honor, even if you take in the narrow definition of safeguarding the family or progeny, because the family is the cornerstone of any society. On the positive side, you find Sharia encouraging young people to get married whenever they can afford, even to be helped in some cases, if that would ward evil from them. The rules pertaining to modesty, the limits and boundaries of interaction between male and female in society. But again, it remains theoretical and a slogan, unless there are also punitive laws for those who aggress against that foundation of any healthy society, the family. That is the punishment for libel or accusing others, especially women. The Quran emphasizes women in particular, accusing them in terms of their chastity without evidence, and the punishment for fornication and adultery. The protection, fifthly, of wealth has its positive side to encourage investment without restriction, except what is required by Islamic law, like payment of zakah, not aggressing against the rights of others, and reasonable distribution of wealth, but there is freedom to do things that are legitimate and acceptable Islamically. Sharia rules pertaining to the protection and safeguarding of the rights of the orphans and those who are vulnerable in society, protection of the property of the person who is insane, the rules of inheritance and estates on the positive side. But again, it remains a slogan unless there is an enforcement mechanism that punishes those who aggress against the right to wealth of others, which is legitimate as well. The third point on that issue of so-called incompatibility is that some people would say that Islamic Sharia encroaches on personal freedoms. We can understand if Sharia has punishments pertaining to various crimes like murder or theft or whatnot. But why encroach on personal freedom by having even a codified or specific punishment for drinking or adultery or fornication if it is not rape, if it is no force is used, if it's consensual? And this kind of questions and reservation that you hear from the West is resulting from the corrupt status quo that drinking is totally a personal matter, consensual sex outside of marriage is totally a personal freedom. Nobody has any right to interfere, or like Pierre Trudeau say, the government has no place in bedrooms, in people's bedrooms. But to say that, if they want to speak about that from secular perspective, that's their right. But Muslims have their human rights as well also to believe in their faith. And to believe according to the two primary sources of Islam that these are not totally individual ills or aberrations. They threaten the whole society and its well-being as well long term. And mind you, if a person commit that without being caught, without declaring it, even he might get away with it. If a Muslim even is drinking in privacy and he's not caught, nobody would snoop on him, or not supposed to snoop on him, no. But the punishment here is when these things become enorm in society, become publicized. That's where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يُحِبُّونَ أَن تَشِيعَ الْفَاحِشَةُ فِي الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ فِي الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ. Those who wish to spread evil and abomination within the Muslim community, they have severe punishment in this life and the hereafter. So again, don't you try to squeeze Islam in a secular frame of reference, we tell them. The fourth point. Some people say, all right, maybe some of the aspect of your Sharia, actually it's a Sharia of Allah, but that's the way you put it. Some aspect of your Sharia might somehow be compatible, at least some, with Western laws, the modern, advanced, civilized laws. But whenever there is any conflict between your Sharia and universally accepted principles in international law or human rights declarations and all of that, you should comply with it because that supersedes any particular nation. The biggest mistake to start with, Islam is not a nation. Islam is not a nation limited by boundaries. Islam is an ummah that includes every person who says La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. And whenever there is any group who have a government like we have today, for example, that tries or intends to apply Islamic law, they're not the ummah, they're part of that ummah. So it is nonsense to speak about the national law that goes across national boundaries. The Ummah of Islam has no boundaries. Secondly, to make that statement, and you must have seen those kind of demands made by non-Muslims, to say that in the name of human rights is in itself a violation of, using even their term, the human rights of Muslims. Why is that? If human rights, even in the internationally known concept, means that you believe what you believe in, you worship Allah the way you want to worship, right? For the Muslim, it is part of belief and worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to implement his law. So to say in the name of human rights, forget about your Islamic human rights, the right to implement your deen, is a glaring contradiction that very few people stop to see the contradiction. A second point, let us ask those who say this, what is really meant by universality? Universality of certain rights or protections or safeguards. To start with, and to be fair, I do not disagree that there may be some basic concepts and ideas in international conventions and international human rights legislations and so on that a Muslim have absolutely no problem with, and really you can admit they are universal in one sense. Example, that the person is innocent until proven otherwise, that they have to be due process of law, that a person who is in trouble legally has the right for counsel and defense, that there should be some appeal mechanism, if, and especially in some serious kind of accusation. A Muslim has absolutely no problem with these universal rights and guarantees, because they have been inherent in Islamic Sharia long time before they were codified in Western laws. It's not a problem. But to use that in a very simplistic and naive way to say that everything that Universal Declaration of Human Rights and others is really universal among all people is really misleading. I'll give you just one example. Remember that huge debate that took place in the United Nations sponsored population conference in Cairo about the definition of the family, the kind of definitions or new definitions of family that has been pushed on the throats of some people. Was that really universal? There were lots of people, there were lots of loud voices that were supporting that. But there were a lot of opposition as well, not only from Muslims, as you know. The Vatican stood against that, and many countries with a strong Catholic presence objected to that as well. By what right then can we say that this is universal? By voting? And what happened in voting in this kind of international forums? I have been in some of them. I've been in one in Austria at one time. And I've seen what goes on. While it appears to be all democratic and open, the reality is that those who set the agenda and organize it are the ones who have the loudest voice. There are certain groups, mostly secular groups, that dominate the agenda. So how do you determine by a majority vote that this is really universal and should be binding on all nations? Otherwise, they would be subjected to pressures and sanctions and all kind of stuff. This is the new imperialism. A third point. Even if you apply this so-called universal declaration that the West thinks in its ethnocentrism that they are the ones really who are so advanced and introducing it to the rest of the backward world, the third world and second world and fourth world, however they classify them. Let us look even at one example of the most advanced Western country in the world, the only remaining so-called superpower, and I'm saying only in material sense. Only in material sense. Are you aware of the debate about capital punishment? Are you aware that there are some states like Texas that allows for capital punishment? What do other international organizations say about it? Amnesty International, what does it say about capital punishment? It is an inhuman and unduly cruel punishment. Yet the most advanced country is implementing that in many states. And it's not only the governments. It's not only the governments. You know that when they make surveys, they find that the opinion is somewhat divided in the United States, in some cases, even some countries in Europe about whether capital punishment should be totally abolished or should still be applicable for cases like mass murderers and all of this, or killing policemen or federal officer or whatever. So how can we really come up with this fancy claim of universality that has been initiated by the advanced West that everybody else has to fall in line with? This is nothing short of arrogance. The bottom line then is that the issue of conformity, when we speak about conformity, that respect of religious freedom and religious freedom of Muslims, among others, to practice their faith, especially those even who put it as a law in a sovereign Muslim country. It is part of the so-called their human rights, as they call it. And from the standpoint of Muslims, their belief in Allah, their loyalty to the rule of Allah, is not to be subjugated to decisions made by any groups of human beings, no matter how universal they claim their decisions might be, which, by the way, keep changing with the changing of time and place as well. The fifth issue, misunderstanding. Islamic Sharia is vengeful. It's not like modern laws that allows room whenever appropriate for forgiveness or even rehabilitation, just vengeance. Nothing is further from truth. But to understand that, we must also refer to the division, the classical division of jurists of the kind of various punishments. First of all, there is the so-called at-ta'azir, or ta'azir, which means discretionary punishment, that there is no clear proof from the Quran and Hadith that there is a specific fixed punishment for that offense, but it is a matter that should be left to the judge or ruler to determine how much should the punishment be for that offense, based on a number of considerations: the seriousness of that offense, the precedent and the record of the person who committed that, the circumstances surrounding it, a number of things. And the ruler or judge may even choose to forgive if indeed there is, you know, extenuating circumstances for that. But it is left for reasonable judgment based on the broader concept of justice. The second category is known as qisas, or retribution, especially in the case of inflicting injury or murder of someone else. And here again, we find the fallacy of the argument that there is no room for forgiveness in Islam. There is more room for forgiveness in Islamic Sharia than in Western laws in some cases. Let me ask you this question. If somebody is accused of murder in Canada or United States, and the family forgives that person, is the person still to be persecuted? Yes. It's a state crime. Under Islamic law, if they forgive with monetary compensation or without monetary compensation, the person may be forgiven. Which one provide even for rehabilitation and forgiveness? A person who committed murder, felt sorry about it, grieved about it, repented, approached the family, asked for their forgiveness, for return or no return. Which one even provide more forgiveness? This is the fallacy, that everything new is always superior to this old stuff. It goes back to 1400 years ago. The third category is known as hudud. It comes from had, limit. That means punishment that has a specific, fixed description, a fixed punishment for certain offenses that include things like adultery, accusing men or women in terms of their sexual purity, intoxication, theft, and similar issues. Once we have looked into this, you can easily realize that not only is there room for forgiveness in Islamic Sharia, there is room for rehabilitation, and the evidence is right there in the Quran. You know, in Surah Al-Ma'idah, إنما جزاء الذين يحاربون الله ورسوله ويسعون في الأرض فسادا أن يقتلوا إلى آخر الآية. It speaks about the punishment of those who fight against Allah and His Messenger and spread corruption on earth. But the ayah defines that. Like people, for example, who stand on the roads, high roads, kill people, rob them, and so on. And that's why you find that the Quran has given variety of punishment, from killing them, from crucifying them, cutting their limbs, sending them in exile. There are a variety of punishment, apparently, depending on the degree of offense they have committed. These are crimes. Again, under Western laws, if a person is caught even 20, 30 years after that, even after he or she stopped, does that get him off the hook? No. So long as the crime has been committed, there is evidence for it, Repent or no repent, you have to be caught. But you know what the Quran says by way of exception? And that's an amazing concept of rehabilitation. إِلَّا الَّذِينَ تَابُوا مِنْ قَبْلِ أَنْ تَقْدِرُوا عَلَيْهِمْ فَعَلَمُوا أَنَّ اللَّهَ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. Except for those who repent before you catch them, then you should know that Allah is most forgiving, most merciful. Isn't that an invitation for rehabilitation? Isn't that a positive way rather than vengeful way? If the concept in Islamic Sharia was vengeance, then they have to pay for their crimes regardless. But look at the philosophy, at the depth of purpose behind it. If I have committed already as a highway robber several murders, one murder, and I know that once I get caught, that's it. What difference does it make to me to change my attitude even if I feel bad about it? If I kill 10 more, still it would be the same punishment. So there is inducement to continue on the wrong path. But if I know, all right, if I get caught, I might be executed because I murdered some people. But if I repent and turn myself to the authorities, I might be forgiven or getting lesser punishment. That's rehabilitation, isn't it? Encouragement of people trying to purify society from crime rather than just punish when the crime is committed. The sixth issue, the most common one. Sharia punishments are brutal, severe, strict, and in some cases they use even a very offensive term, barbaric. You must have seen that term in the papers. There are five basic points, but the fifth one would expand to 12. First question. Who has the right to determine or classify a punishment as brutal, severe, strict, inhuman, uncivilized, or barbaric, whatever term is used? Is there even full agreement, even in the Western society, about those definitions? Has it been settled yet? I have already given an example earlier, capital punishment. The debate still rages on. So who has the right to come and say, all right, I think that particular punishment is okay, is human, acceptable. This one is brutal, this is super brutal, this is barbaric. Who has that authority? And by what authority, what criteria are to be used except arousing of emotion? This is gruesome, Secondly, let's ask an honest question to honest people, Muslims or non-Muslims. What were the results of leniency in implementation of criminal codes in the Western societies? What is happening? In the name of avoiding brutality, greater brutality has been inflicted on those societies, to the point that in some places people cannot even leave home after a certain period of time or go in certain areas without the fear of some criminal activity. Again, we're not talking about the social, corrupt social structure that might give rise and induce or push people to the brink of the commission. I'm just talking about the leniency that has taken place in dealing with severe crimes like this. A third question. Who can tell me as to which one is more brutal? Somebody committing an act for which he gets 80 lashes, or someone who is put in a cage known as prison or jail for 15 years, becoming worse, learning more crime from hardcore criminal? Which one is more humane? Which one is more gruesome? And who can say for sure that one is better than the other? Number four. By what right does any person, when we talk about the right of the criminal and the due process, fine, due process is okay, but by what right can any person who commits aggression and disregard the basic rights of other people, right of life, honor, property, or whatnot, to say, no, you cannot punish me, you should respect my human dignity and my human rights? If I did not respect the human rights and dignity of others, I have already forsaken my rights to demand that. I'm not saying to kill the person a slow death or to cut them into pieces or torture or mutilate them. Obviously, that's forbidden in Islamic Sharia. But basically, the point is this. If I did not fulfill my duty and respect the rights of others, and I aggress against, I cannot say it's a matter of human rights that I should get away from that or get a lighter punishment. So I kill someone and go to jail for 3 years and get parole after 1.5 or 1 year. The fifth point, that if we really look carefully at the severest of punishment or hudud in Sharia, you find that it has been subjected to very severe and very strict controls. And that's where I have like 12 points, but inshallah I go fast. But these are very essential ones, because inshallah you will find them based on the primary sources of Islam. And it might amaze some that this is part of Islamic Sharia, vis-a-vis the misunderstanding in the West and among some Muslims even themselves. The first point to bring to mind is that when Sharia law or the criminal, severe criminal punishments are applied, it has to be applied equally to ruler and ruled. You don't cut the hands of poor people, because I'll show even a poor person who steals because of poverty may not even be punished. But you don't punish the commoner and let the ruler and those connected with the rulers, the ruler and his crony, get away with stealing millions scot-free. The Prophet ﷺ made it clear, لَوْ أَنَّ فَاطِمَةَ بِنْتَ مُحَمَّدٍ سَرَقَتْ لَقَطَعْتْ يَدَهُ. He says, if Fatima, and we know how much he loved her, if Fatima, the daughter of Muhammad, stole, I would cut her hand. There's no distinction. And he said it clearly in a hadith, that what this corrupted people before you is that when the person in high status steals, he's let go, and when a poor person committed that, the punishment is implemented on them. They have been warned against that, and unfortunately that's not implemented in many Muslim countries, including those that claim also that they try to implement the Sharia. Secondly, since again the variety of punishments might branch too much, and again, in the spirit of the event in Nigeria, I'll focus largely on the adultery and fornication, even though some of those principles apply in other areas as well. The second point, if you focus on the issue of adultery, you notice that the Islamic term zina actually includes two categories. One is fornication and the other is adultery, but the term is used to include both of them. And we should make it clear from the outset that the punishment for a person who has not married or is not married is not a capital punishment. It is lashes, 100 lashes. For the person who, again, there's difference among jurists, who is called muhsan, and I'll explain to you, the punishment is capital punishment. But here they differed how to interpret muhsan. Some said a person who has married before, even though he may not be married now, he could be, you know, divorced or something. But the one who has already, uhsan, at one point of time he got married. But there are some jurists, however, who disputed that and said, no, muhsan means at the time, married at the time of the commission of the crime. Of course, maybe possibly one of the rationale behind that is that he might be just like the bachelor because he doesn't have a wife. So this is a matter of, again, difference of opinion among some jurists. But the bottom line is that there is a distinction between muhsan and a person who has not married. A third principle, that a Muslim should not be too eager to report a moral slip of his brother or sister, and he is actually taught by the Prophet ﷺ to conceal that. I'm not talking about concealing theft or concealing, you know, some other crime that really threatens society and should not be let go. But when you talk about a moral slip, like adultery or fornication, serious as it may be, we are taught by the Prophet ﷺ not to be too eager to go and report the person who did that. In Sahih Muslim, the Prophet ﷺ say, لا يستر عبد عبدا في الدنيا إلا ستره الله يوم القيامة. That there is no servant of Allah who conceals, mean this fault or mistake of another servant of Allah, except that Allah will conceal that person's faults and shortcomings in the Day of Judgment. But then we find a number of interesting ahadith, both in Abu Dawood and Muwatta Malik, that even deal specifically with issues of fornication and adultery. Let me give you some. A man by the name of Hazzal came to a friend of his by the name of Ma'iz. That person, Ma'iz, actually told his friend Hazzal that he committed adultery. Not fornication, adultery. So Hazzal told him, why don't you go to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and tell him about that? In another version of the hadith, it says, maybe the Prophet will pray for forgiveness for you. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam knew that, and I'm only taking that part of the hadith that related that because I'm coming to another point later concerning the same person. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam knew about that, as reported in Muwatta Malik, he said to him, يا هزال لو سترته بردائك كان خيرا لك. He said, هزال, if you covered him with your garment, conceal that evil, it would have been better. Better than what? Better by telling him to come to me. I.e., maybe he would go and repent since Allah has covered that and nobody caught him. In another version of that hadith in Abu Dawood, the Prophet ﷺ tells that Ma'iz, who came to confess already, tell him, maybe you just kissed. And the man says, no. He said, maybe you just winked. And he says, no. He said, maybe you just looked. He said, no. In another version of the hadith, it says, did you sleep with her? The Prophet giving so many questions, not only to confirm, but to give a chance to the person to recant. If the person stop in the middle and say, excuse me, I'll go. The Prophet say, go. And I give you evidence from further ahadith. So, did you sleep with her? He said, yes. Did you touch her? Say, yes. Did you have intercourse with her? He said, yes. Of course, there would be no choice left but to implement, though otherwise it becomes a joke. But the person did not get the message. And maybe Hazzal carries some responsibility. He's the one who pushed him to do that. The fourth point. Even if the crime or adultery or fornication is reported to the ruler or judge, the judge should not be too eager himself to say, oh, hey, yes, you caught him. Gotcha. Let's get the process through. No. Actually, the jurist has said that there are two cases here, and all based on hadith. One is a person who goes to the ruler or judge and he says, I committed something that requires the had, the fixed punishment, but without specifying. He doesn't say, I committed adultery, I stole, nothing. They say in that case, he cannot be punished. Anas radiallahu anh said, I was sitting with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and a man came. Look at this mercy of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. A man came to him and he said, O Messenger of Allah, I committed an act that requires this severe fixed had punishment. So please, punish me. But the man didn't say what it was. What did the Prophet say? Oh, tell me what it is? No, the Prophet didn't ask. Did not ask him even. And then the time for prayer came, azan was made, iqama, Muslims standed to pray, and that man joined the prayer. After the prayer, he came to the Prophet ﷺ again, and he said, Ya Rasulallah, O Messenger of Allah, I did something that required had, so please apply the book of Allah on me, means the punishment. What did the Prophet ﷺ say? Did he start asking questions, what was it, where and when? And he said, didn't you pray with us? He said, yes. He said, Allah has forgiven you your dhanb, your mistake. In another version, your had. Allah has forgiven you your had. That's narrated, you know where? In Bukhari, in volume 8. A very authentic hadith. The second case is the worst, where the person come and confess and specifies the offense or crime that he did. Even here, the ruler or judge should not be too eager to implement it and should give a chance to the person, ultimate, maximum chance for the person to get out of it or recant on his confession. Evidence in hadith, there are numerous. I'll give you one. Narrated by Abu Hurairah, radiallahu anhu, that's in Bukhari also, that a man came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the masjid, and he said, O Messenger of Allah, I committed adultery. So here is had specified, the worst case scenario for the person. You know what did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say? The hadith says, فَأَعْرَضَ عَنْهُ. The Prophet turned away from him, as if, I don't want to listen, as if, turned his face away from him. The man kept coming back, facing the Prophet. 4 times he kept repeating that. What now the Prophet could say, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, instead of 4 witnesses, he witnesses against himself 4 times. And by the way, some jurists, a few like Zahiris and others, say that it is enough for the person to confess only once, but other jurists said that he has, even if you're confessing, to repeat it 4 times. So even here, with 4 times repeated by the person, you know what did the Prophet ﷺ say? Abika junoon? Are you insane? Are you mad? And the man says, no. He says, all right. Hal uhsant, which could be interpreted, are you married or have you married? Whichever. Have you married also could refer to the first wife or second, if he has divorced. Allahu a'lam, this is an issue, again, of debate. But if you take it in the more softer interpretation, let's say, are you married or have you been married? And he said, yes. And the Prophet, again, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, had no choice. Again, it becomes a joke. After all that, giving at any stage, if the person changed, he would have gone free and he would have gone and made his tawbah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There was a case of another woman from Juhayna who came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and bluntly said, "Inni habla min al-zina." O Prophet of Allah, I am pregnant from adultery. Apparently she was married also. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to her guardian, "Take her and treat her well." Remember again the Nigerian case. She was not in prison. He said, "Take her and treat her well, and when she gives birth, then tell me." And when she came back and the penalty was implemented, the Prophet ﷺ made funeral prayer on her. So Umar comes to him and he says, you ordered that she would be stoned to death and you make funeral prayer on her. In other words, does she deserve that after that crime? And the Prophet ﷺ said that this woman had made a kind of repentance, a type of repentance, which if divided between 70 of the people of Medina, it would be suffice for them. What is more than sacrificing her life for the sake of Allah? Of course, like I said, if she recanted, he would have not implemented that, but the fact she's insisting, knowing that this is capital punishment, that shows her devotion to Allah, even though perhaps this is not the most appropriate course of action for her to take, but at least appreciated her devotion. Suckle. That was known among Arabs. But he gives a chance. Your baby needs you. Go and suckle your baby until he's weaned. And you know how long does it take to wean a child? According to the Quran, it could be a maximum of 2 years. وَفِصَالُهُ فِي عَمَيْنِ. As much as 2 years delay and postpone, not, you know, you give birth, come, let's quickly apply. Go and, you know, feed your child. She comes back with the child eating solid food in her hand. Keeps pushing. Of course, no alternative was left but to implement it. A fifth point of the 12. Inshallah, we're getting somewhere. That if the person recanted, even after confessing, and the ruling has already been issued that the person should be punished this way, but he recanted even after that, he can go free. In fact, it was narrated by Abdullah ibn Buraida, narrated from his father, or through his father. He said, we companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam were sitting talking. That was not with the Prophet, they were sitting. But Sahaba, of course, were closer to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the spirit of Sharia. So you say, we Sahaba were sitting discussing about the story of Ma'iz, the person I mentioned earlier, and another woman known as Al-Ghamidiyya, who also confessed, that if these two individuals who were stoned to death, if they returned back after their confession, لم يطلبهما, the Prophet ﷺ would have never sought them. This was the understanding of Sahaba. Even after the verdict is issued, if they say, I recant, that's it. Not only this, if even the punishment begins, and the person escapes, it is not desirable to keep following him. And there was an incident also at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's the case of Ma'iz, that they started stoning him, so he couldn't take it, so he started running. But they were so zealous, they were so eager to implement the law, that they kept following until he died. And when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam heard that, he told them, هَلَّا تَرَكْتُمُوا لَعَلَّهُ أَنْ يَتُوب فَيَتُوبَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ. Why didn't you let him? Maybe perchance he would seek forgiveness of Allah and Allah will forgive him. The sixth point. Rules of evidence in this hard criminal punishment are very, very severe and very strict. First of all, you have to have four witnesses who seen everything in details, not something suspicious or covered, in details, graphic details. But furthermore, those four witnesses must insist and persist in their testimony until the end. If one of them changes his mind, maybe the three could, or all four perhaps even, could be punished because of qazf, because of accusation. That itself is discouragement to be too eager to say, yeah, I saw, even if you have seen something terrible like that, even if 10 people saw that, it would be very difficult to find enough who are ready to go before the judge, knowing that this could be capital punishment for another person who could repent if they understood the spirit of the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. With the danger and risk that any one of them who might change his mind, that might bring some punishment for them. It's very difficult. Number two, pregnancy. Pregnancy itself is seen by some jurists as not necessarily a definitive, irrevocable evidence of the commission of zina. You might say, what? How could that be even given benefit of doubt? Look at what jurists said, and you would be surprised even about the scientific mind of some of them. Some of them said that a woman may possibly get pregnant without penetration and still remain virgin. And you know scientifically today that a sperm could get into a woman even though she's still virgin. The possibility might be very remote, but even that remote possibility was one reason why pregnancy even is not a definitive, of course short of confession, but in itself it cannot be a final definitive evidence in the opinion of some jurists. Secondly, they said that it is possible also that pregnancy took place as a result of intercourse by mistake. You know, somebody at night who might found a woman sleeping, thought his wife. It's a remote, very remote thing. But even that was given as a benefit of doubt for her. Thirdly, and that is more important, especially in the Nigerian case, very important, they say maybe pregnancy was bil ikrah. It was not consensual intercourse, but maybe somebody raped that particular woman. As a result, she became pregnant. So, to the shock of some, even pregnancy itself is not an automatic evidence to implement the capital punishment here. Number seven, I think. That elaborate on the same point. Al-Shafi'i, Ahmad, and Abu Hanifa, three major jurists of the three Sunni schools, three of the four, say that if there is no evidence of adultery but pregnancy, and the woman claimed that she has been forced into that, there is no had to be applied to her. Keep that in mind in view of the coverage of that case. Number 8, even if the woman does not claim that she was raped, there is no had to be applied also if there is no clear confession or other irrevocable or irrefutable evidence of that. 9, if there is a case involving two persons and only one of them confessed to committing zina and the other one denied, the had cannot be applied on the other person if he denied. It can apply only to the person who confessed. In fact, if the person who confessed and he said that he had intercourse with X and that X denied, some jurists say that he could be punished by being lashed for attacking the owner of someone else, even though he confessed. So he gets two punishments, for his confession and for accusing another person who refused that she committed that crime. Isn't that also a sort of discouragement for the person to confess even on himself for the fear of double punishment? Okay? Wa'il ibn Hajar reported that a woman was raped by force at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. It says, فَدَرَأَ عَنْهَا الْحَدْ وَأَقَامَهُ عَلَى الَّذِي أَصَابَهَا. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam did not apply any punishment to her, but he punished the one who was proven to have committed that act. That means the person who raped her. So you don't victimize the victim. You punish actually the culprit. Okay? Okay, number 11. So we're getting there. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam made it clear the basic principle of idra'ul hududa bishubuhat, that whenever there is any shubha, and I'm not translating it for a good reason, whenever there is any shubha in a criminal punishment, it should be commuted, not applied. Some people who know Arabic, when they hear the term shubha, they say, okay, the literal meaning is doubt. Was it done or was it not done? But actually, in the legal Islamic sense, the concept of shubha is not only doubt whether things happened or not, but also extenuating circumstances and any benefit of doubt that can be given to the person. That's why with this fiqh and understanding, Umar radiallahu anh considered poverty and hunger as shubha, even if the person is proven to have committed theft. But hunger itself and shortage of food or famine, in his fiqh and understanding, was a shubha. Not that the person is doubtful. It's proven to have committed it. But that was shubha. The penalty was not applied. In a similar case, when some person brought his servants that they committed theft, and he asked them and they confessed, he didn't hasten to cut their hands. When he asked them and he knew that their master does not feed them or look after them, he fined that person twice the value of the animal that was stolen from which they ate. So they actually punished the person who's the master rather than the person who committed theft itself. That's the spirit of Sharia, that you have to remove the causes of crime first before you apply the criminal punishment. It's not vengeance. It actually remove the reasons, every reason, whether sexual misconduct or theft or any other, justice, purity in society. And after you provide all of that help and support, if somebody disregarded all of that, well, he deserved the severe punishment. If you want to call it brutal, call it whatever you want, but after all that guarantee, there have to be protection of society as well. But there is a hadith, and let me read you that hadith also in translation at least, in which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam say, let me say it in Arabic also, idra'u al-hududa 'an al-muslimina mastata'tum fa'in kana lahu makhrajun fakhallu sabila fa'inna al-imama an yukhti'a fil-'afwi khayrun من أن يخطئ في العقوبة. This is an amazing rule for the question of evidence and the mercy of Sharia. Translation, free translation. Whenever possible, refrain from awarding or meeting a punishment on a Muslim, male or female, it uses just Muslim. If there is the slightest excuse or doubt, leave him, you can say, or her, alone. It is better for the judge to err in acquitting the accused rather than erring in meeting a punishment or meeting the punishment. To make a mistake in letting someone who committed a mistake or crime free, better than punishing someone who might be proven to be innocent. And you hear of cases of people executed, and after that, it's discovered they are not to be blamed for that, they were innocent, you cannot correct it. So it's better, actually, it says, to forgive or to give lesser sentence than to make a mistake that is really uncorrectable. Number 12. Even in the implementation of the Hadd, if it meets all of those very, very strict requirements, consideration should be given to illness or weakness of the person. It was said that Ali radiallahu anhu delayed the punishment of a woman during her postpartum bleeding. She gave birth and she was still bleeding, for fear that if she's punished at that point or lashed, she may die. And when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam knew that, what did he tell him? You're slack in implementing the law. He says, Ahsant, Ahsant, you did the right thing. There was a reported case also in Abu Dawood of a person who was sick and weak. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was told that if we hit him, his bones will be broken. He's so weak, so fragile. He said, all right, you get some branch that has 100, you know, leaves or something, and hit him once with it. Like Sayyidina Ayyub, as some Mufassirin say. So he gets the 100 lashes, but all at once, just something, you know, in consideration. I'm not for everyone, not for the big husky fellows who can deserve it, but for someone who's in that stage. Coming to the final two concluding remarks, number 7-1, on how does all of that Sharia and the spirit of Sharia, and I hope I didn't take too long, but I think the topic probably is very serious and very sensitive. How does this understanding we have hopefully developed tonight apply to the case of that Nigerian teenagers? 7 remarks, because I was saddened that sometimes the reaction went to two kind of extremes. There are some people who say, yes, she deserves it, that's Sharia, the rule of Allah. So you get one extreme, and you get other extreme, as if they want to dissociate themselves from Muslims, or even if they present and speak about Islam and Muslims, they're so apologetic and so, you know, trying somehow to give some better picture, put good face on it. Of course, some of them might have some excuses, because I know in media interviews you're not giving all the time you want and you have to prepare carefully for that. So let's look at it in a more clear term without going in one extreme or the other. Number 1. The sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was not followed by people who reported her. Like we said earlier, one rule is what? Not to be eager to report something that someone else has done. Satr is better, as the Prophet taught in the case of Ma'az. Number 2. We said also that the ruler or judge should not be eager to jump on the opportunity and say, oh, we got you. And we have seen that in the action of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Actually, in some ahadith, and it says the woman came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and said, I committed adultery. He said, you go home. She come back the next day and she said, I commit adultery. He said, go home. Until she kept repeating that, there was no alternative but to ask her and continue with the process. So there is another violation. No chance, no following of the sunnah, not following the pressure from the West, following of the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in trying to find some way for her, especially being a young woman. Number 3, she was pregnant and that was taken as a definitive evidence, you could have benefited from the doubt because it is a disputed issue among jurists, and you could adopt also the view that even pregnancy cannot be definitive if she did not confess that this was done consensually with her agreement. Number four, that girl accused her father's friend of raping her or pressuring her, maybe with the consent of her father, to pay his debt to them. I am in no position to confirm whether this was right or wrong, but it has been reported. If indeed that is true, then her accusation, mere accusation or claim that she has been raped, is a shubha in itself that make it far from definitive that she should be receiving the punishment for fornication. Number five, as we indicated, the basic rules of justice in Islam allows for a person to seek the help of others to help him in defense. The question that I don't know the answer of, but if the media, which is usually distorted, is correct, then it is wrong that she did not have access or benefit of counsel. Number six, that there must have been or should have been more careful examination, not simply to ask the three men that she accused and say, all right, if they deny, they just go scot-free like that. Actually, have medical technology today that you could still try to verify her story. So whether or not the investigation with those three friends of her father was too light, I think it's a matter, if true, it would be highly questionable. Number seven, Islamic law also allows for appeal. Was there a possibility of some appeal of the decision of a lower court judge who may have some knowledge of Sharia, but perhaps in view of what we said, it's not necessarily the perfect knowledge? Could there be another religious authority, another mufti, more knowledgeable person to refer to? And it is known in Islamic history, by the way, this is something that started early in jurisprudence in Islam, that they made a distinction between two categories of people, the judge and the mufti. The judge is the one who implements the law. The mufti is more learned scholar who codifies the law according to their understanding of Sharia so that the judge would implement them. So there are also some possibility of going to higher authority or more knowledgeable scholar who might have given some kind of ruling on that. Maybe another question could be added, and I'm not delving into that. Is there possibility that the political climate in Nigeria and the opposition on the part of some Christians supported by the West in states in the northern part of Nigeria to implement Sharia resulted in some sort of political situation? I think if you've read Brother Harun Siddiqui's editorial, I think it's quite interesting in that. But that's an issue also that does not justify what happened, but may explain some of the political and social background for this kind of position that has been taken. A final conclusion, comment on the attitude of media and politicians, including our own Prime Minister here. One, every month, every single month, nearly 5,000 Iraqi children die because of lack of food and medication. That's not a normal death. It is a slow, painful, torturous death. Every single month, tens of teenagers, some as young as 8 or 10 years old, Palestinians, are shot deliberately in the head, eyes, or the heart. And every single month, hundreds of them are injured, some very seriously, with disabling injuries. Same thing is happening in Kashmir under Indian occupation. The cruelty and brutality that has been documented in so many pictures and the extent of it is just beyond imagination. You're talking about tens of thousands of murdered. The question here is this. The case of that Nigerian teenager became an issue of an international dimension in the media and among legislators. قامت الدنيا ولم تقعد. Everything went up and never settled. Human rights, so-called groups, Amnesty International, women's rights groups, feminist groups, and all of these. My question is this. Where were those groups and voices and politicians when all these cruelties has taken place and is constantly taking place on an ongoing basis? Where were these women's groups that sympathize with that poor girl? I sympathize with her, of course, no question, if you apply the rules that you spoke about. But how about Muslim women who are dismissed from their jobs, fired from their universities because they wear hijab, and are harassed even in the so-called Muslim countries like Tunisia and Turkey? Where were those freedom lovers, defenders of human rights and women's rights? Have they spoken about the rights of people to wear hijab as much as they spoke about the right of women to take off their hijab and wear virtually nothing? Where were they? Where was the government of Canada or United States or other civilized, quote-unquote, countries from the diplomatic pressure that has been applied on the Nigerian government? Where was the parallel diplomacy about the usurpation of the rights of Palestinian people and protest to the occupying force, so-called Israel, in the occupied land of Palestine with all the cruelties and massacres they are doing? And what are those so-called big power themselves doing, especially Britain, United States, with the approval of Canada, that its successive governments considered itself like an appendix of the policy of the United States rather than an independent sovereign government? Where they have been and what are they doing to the people of Iraq, the mass killing? And they defend themselves or depict themselves as the kind, compassionate nations and people defending the right of one teenager, but forget about these rivers of blood of Muslims shed everywhere. Is that a case of double standard, or more accurately, sheer hypocrisy, that the life and blood of Muslims, tens of thousands, is not important? But when one Muslim is wronged, and it suits the agenda of Islam bashing and attack Sharia and Islam and Muslim people, then that becomes a cause célèbre that takes all that attention. Our duty in conclusion is that we should develop our own understanding of our own deen, our own Sharia, and to approach all people, and there are a lot of people who are not Muslims, but who have a sense of fairness and honor, that perchance they may join in raising their voice with us against those double standards, against what I call the new but old, persistent, international, highly coordinated and planned to bash Islam in a new crusade. But I conclude with the note of hope from the Quran. وَقُلْ جَاءَ الْحَقُّ وَزَهَقَ الْبَاطِلُ إِنَّ الْبَاطِلَ كَانَ زَهُوقًا. And say truth has prevailed and falsehood has vanished. Indeed, falsehood is bound to vanish sooner or later, inshallah. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.